Heavenly Father, we would rejoice in you this morning. Such a blessing to know that you're in control, that you love us, that you proved your love for us by dying on the cross for our sins, Lord, that death couldn't hold you down, but you rose again. You are sitting at the right hand of the Father, and we're here, Lord, to celebrate you, to rejoice in you, to glorify you, to be transformed by you, Lord. We exalt you, Lord. We ask that by your Spirit, you would reveal your truths to our heart, that you would transform us by the renewing of our minds, Lord, that you would change us, Lord. I pray for anybody here that may not know you, that may not have a personal relationship with you, that their sins may not be forgiven, that if they were to die today, they would not be sure where they would spend eternity. I want to pray for them this morning, Lord, that you would quicken their heart, Lord, that you'd awaken them to their need, their desperate need for you, Lord. We pray, Lord, that your will be done in Jesus' name. So, amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, go ahead and take them out. Turn to the book of Revelation, the last book in your Bible. An amazing book. A fun book to study. And not a difficult book, is it? The book of Revelation, we find, is a book that tells us how everything is going to end. And the book of Revelation spells it out in detail. And it's given to us so that you and I will be encouraged and be motivated to passionately follow Jesus in the last days. In the last days. So you know how you get that a little extra motivation when you can see the light at the end of the tunnel? You know, if you're in school and you know it's your last year or your last semester, there seems to be like, okay, we can really go for it because it's coming up. Something's coming up. The book of Revelation is like that. The book of Revelation tells us something's coming up. And the book of Revelation tells us that something's coming up, and here's how it's going to come, and here's what's going to go down. So when you see these things, Jesus in his gospel says, when you see these things, watch, be ready, look, have an attitude that you're at the goal line, that you're at the finish line. Let me ask you a question. In these days that we live in, would you honestly say that you are passionately following Jesus, that you enjoy it, that you're on fire for the Lord? You don't have to answer that. Like, no. The book of Revelation is to help us understand that Jesus is coming back. Jesus has worked out his plan, and he told us how it's going down. He's been doing that for all of history. We can look back on history and see, yeah, he's worked out everything exactly like he said. Do you know if you're a Christian and you know your Bible, you know how everything's going down? You know what's going to happen? The book of Revelation, as we get into it then, it gives us some keys, right? It gives us some keys to understanding. You may say, I've read through the book of Revelation. There's a lot of weird stuff in there. A lot of stuff that's hard to understand. Yeah, because we're told in chapter 1, the book of Revelation is signified. What do you mean? It's written in sort of codes or signals. No, not like weird, you know, Da Vinci code. It's written where it takes pictures and illustrations from the Old Testament to help us to understand more clearly the things that are being said. So you bring forward things from the Old Testament. Another thing is we understand that the book of Revelation, it's unveiling, not covering up. It's unveiling what? It's unveiling Jesus Christ. Chapter 1 tells us that. The book, the word revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ in chapter 1 says it's the unveiling, uncovering of Jesus Christ. So we have to read it with an eye on Jesus, right? We have to read it thinking about, okay, this is a book about Jesus. This is unveiling. Unveiling of his kingdom, unveiling of his plan, unveiling of his working. So you say, that sounds good so far. So far, so good. But also the book of Revelation has a built-in outline. It has an outline in it. John, the writer of the book of Revelation, was on the island of what? Patmos, which is an actual island off Greece. It's like more like Alcatraz, we've pointed out. It's not like Hawaii, it's more like Alcatraz. They wanted to get rid of him. During those days, the apostles, the disciples were being martyred and killed. Every one of them gave their life for Jesus Christ. And John was the last living disciple. He couldn't be killed. They tried to. Church history tells us they put him in a pot of boiling oil. They're very creative in their killing of Christians. And he didn't boil, so they just said, let's just get rid of this guy. Let's stick him on this rocky, barren island. And on that island, the Lord gave him this vision and told him to write it down. And he said, this vision to write down, write the things that you see. What did he see? Chapter 1 in the book of Revelation. He saw a vision of Jesus Christ. You can go read it. A vision of Jesus Christ, a description of Jesus Christ. Write the things you see. And then he says, write the things which are. In John's day, as he is on the island writing this, what were the things that are? The things that are was the present day that he was living in, and it was the things of the churches. Write about the churches. And that's chapter 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation. Write the things which are. And so write the things that are seen. Write the things which are. And then write the things that come after this. Key word, after this. After what? After the church. What happens after the church? Well, the church is in heaven, Revelation 4 and 5. And then a 7-year tribulation period, like the earth has never seen before, where God pours out his wrath on a Christ-rejecting world. Chapter 6 through 19. Then what happens? Jesus comes back to the earth with his church. Where was the church? In heaven with him. Comes back with the church to set up his 1,000-year reign called the millennial kingdom on earth. So then we see after that, we see the new heavens and the new earth. And the end of the book says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you forever and ever. Amen. Amen. So should we all go home now? So that's the book of Revelation. It's not a hard book to understand. So we're right now, right smack dab in the middle of John writing down the things which are. What were the things that are? The churches. So he's writing down the things that are. He has messages to give to 7 churches. These were 7 churches in the area of Asia Minor, which in the Roman Empire was Turkey now. So these were actual churches that existed, and he's writing these letters to them, and we can look at these churches, interestingly enough. I know this is review for some of you, but this is important. He's writing to these churches, one, specifically for that church and the problems that that church was having, if they're having problems, and what to do about it. Number 2, he was writing to churches that span the time of the whole church age. So throughout church history, for you church history buffs, the church has gone through several different phases or eras. Amazing how each one of these churches in order represent the orders of church history in their phases to a T. So we can look at that in regards to learning from church history. And then we can look at it in regards to our church. We can look at the letters to the churches and say, what is our church doing right? What is our church doing wrong? What do we need to turn from? What do we need to repent from? Is that valuable today? We need to know what God thinks about the church. Especially when there's so much confusion and so much noise and so many differences of opinion about what a church should do and what a church should be, we can go right to the source and say, this is what Jesus thinks is good in a church, and this is what Jesus thinks is bad in a church. So if you're church hopping or church shopping, I would ask you or encourage you to take out the Revelation list, to use that as your shopping list. Don't go by the world's standards of what the world says is a successful church. Go by what Jesus says. Because after all, the church is built on Jesus Christ, and He is the head of the church. So what does He say about it? And then finally, we find in the book of Revelation that then we have things that speak to us individually. What is the church? The church is people called out by God to follow Him. And so there's individual lessons and messages for us today. So the book of Revelation, it's an unveiling. It has a built-in outline. It brings references and pictures from the Old Testament forward to help us understand. And it has pertinent messages for us today. So the seven churches, the book of Revelation uses the number seven a lot. The seven churches, seven is the number of completion or perfection. The seven churches, each church, it has a certain outline as well. So the book of Revelation is not a hard book to understand, is it? It's in fact just the opposite. So what's the outline? Each church has a personal introduction of Jesus Christ taken from the revelation of Jesus Christ in chapter 1. So in chapter 1, we get a description of Jesus. And then part of that is taken for each of the church as an individual, personalized introduction of who Jesus is. So then, after the personal introduction, he has what's good about the church, what's bad about the church, what they are to do about that, and then an eternal motivation to do the right thing. So we got all that down now? Okay, let's get into it. This is great. So we're on our third church, Revelation chapter 2, verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos, write these things, says he who has the sharp two-edged sword. So there's our personal introduction. So he's writing to the third church. This was about 60 to 70 miles north of our last church, which was Smyrna. Smyrna, if you remember last week, it represented a time in church history from about 180 AD to about 313-12 AD, where the church went through 10 Roman emperors who persecuted the church heavily. Approximately estimated 6 million Christians died during that time. And you know what happened? The church grew. It is said that is the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. We learned something very important from that era of church history. That's the era of church history you may be familiar with, where they fed Christians to lions and they stretched them to death on those stretching torture machines. And so this is an amazing time period where through those persecutions, the church actually grew. And this is interesting, because we have a thought in our day and age and in our culture where the church will do better if we have more power and control. We have an idea and a thought to where if the church has more money, if it's more empowered politically, if The church has better connections and more things that resemble the world, then the church is going to be more successful. Church history is just the opposite. It was the persecution of the church that made the church grow. In our world, we see the church exploding like never before, but not in our country. We see the church exploding in places where the church is being persecuted. And that was that era of Smyrna. Satan's smart. So as the church is exploding and Satan's coming against the church from the outside, he decided to join the church. The word Pergamos is interesting. It actually means per. In Greek, means opposition. And gamos, the second part, means marriage. Pergamos means objectionable marriage. It means connecting with or marrying something, being involved with in a way that one should not be involved with. The Bible says not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. That means that to have a certain relationship where you're relating to people who don't know the Lord in a way where you're compromising. You got that? Compromising. Did you know that as a believer, as a Christian, the world may say that compromise is good, but we don't find that in the Bible. Why? When you have Jesus Christ, you have the whole thing, right? Any compromise with the whole thing is a lessened state of what you've been given. So anytime we compromise, it's a taking away or a surrendering of the wholeness of what we've been given. And that's why the Bible says that all the commandments are summed up into loving God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. We've been given everything in Christ. So now when we begin to compromise, or when we begin to make associations or relationships to where, you know, we say it's a give and take thing. You know, I'm going to give you a little and you give me a little. That sounds good. That's very diplomatic, but not when it comes to Christ. Christ is not diplomatic, and he's not one to compromise with. And so the church in that era, in that time, this is the time where Constantine in the Roman Empire, he was fighting for control, fighting for the power of the Roman Empire. And one day he says, the story goes, where in the sky he saw a sign, a Christian sign, and he realized that he needed to conquer in the name of Christ. And legend has it, story has it, I should say, history has it, he became a Christian. That's very debatable. That's very questionable if he really became born again and a real Christian. But now he made everybody in the Roman Empire. Imagine after years of being slaughtered, Christians being slaughtered, now he issued an edict of toleration, meaning you can't persecute Christians anymore. Hey, that sounds great. Finally. And all of a sudden, the Christians, who are the lowest in society, they moved up into the power position in society. They were the power group. In fact, Constantine made it mandatory for every child to be baptized as a Christian. And we saw some of the weakest and worst days of Christianity during this time, where the church married the state. The church wanted the legislation and the politics to do the job of the Holy Spirit. The church became weak. You can see that that's something we need to concern ourselves with, be careful about, is our mixture of politics and spiritual relationship. We'll talk a little bit about that more as we go along. So The angel of the church, and he's given the message. The angel is the pastors of these churches, and he's given this message. But notice something very important. The introduction is, he says, write these things, says he who has a sharp two-edged sword. That's key. The church of Pergamos, they needed to remember that the one in whom was writing this letter was the one that had a sharp two-edged sword. What does that mean? The book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 12, tells us that the word of God is living, it's active, and it's what? Sharper than any two-edged sword. And so the message and the personal introduction to this church is that you need to understand, when you're making all these handshakes and deals, and when you're in a place of unhealthy connections to the things of the world, whatever that may be, you need to understand he who has the last word is talking to you now. He who has the truth, that's double-edged truth. You ever wonder why it says it's a double-edged sword? It's double-edged because we can fall on the good part of the sword or the bad part of the sword. It's double-edged because there's one thing that doesn't change and doesn't move. It is the standard, and that is the Word of God. And so the Word of God, one side of it is, it sets us free. It gives us life. It brings us into a relationship with Jesus Christ. It directs our paths. It gives us the ways and the keys to live our life. It gives us everything we need pertaining to life and godliness. It's the Word of God. But not everybody feels that way. To some people, the Word of God, it hurts. It cuts. People don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear what the Bible says. I don't want to be confronted with accountability that one day I'll have to answer to how I respond to the truth of God. So there's a constant. It's the Word of God. It's the truth of God. It comes from the mouth of Jesus Christ. The variable is people. How we respond to God's Word, the unchangeable truth of God, will dictate to us how the sword affects us. So ask yourself a question. Do you love God's Word? Do you read it and you connect with Jesus Christ in a relationship? Do you read it and do you hear from the Lamb of God who is slain from the foundations of the world? See, this isn't a book that we read for information. This book is alive. That's why the book of Hebrews says it's living, it's active. When you read the Word of God and you're a Christian, you have the Holy Spirit in you, you read the Word and it's as if Jesus is talking to you himself. So, which is it? I just want you to think about that. What role does the Word of God have in your life? That's going to come into play here in a second. So that's a personal introduction. Now look what he says. Verse 13. Here's the good. He says, I know your works, and I know where you dwell, where you live, where Satan's throne is. That doesn't seem like a good neighborhood. And he says, and you hold fast to my name and did not deny my faith even in the days in which Antipas, my faithful martyr, and that term was used, same term was used to describe Jesus Christ in chapter 1, faithful martyr or faithful witness, the same Greek word, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells. So here's the situation. So they're living in a place in Pergamos where there was a lot of pagan deity temples. It was a mixture in Pergamos because they had a temple to the goddess Roma, which represented the Roman Empire. So the Roman Empire itself had its own goddess and they had a temple. But this is also the place where in Greek mythology they said that Zeus was born. And Zeus was looked at as a savior. Not only that, this was a place that was sort of a medical place, a place where they had healing. They had a temple and a goddess of healing, which was represented by a snake wrapped around a pole. Does that sound familiar? That's the medical profession's emblem. And they had a temple where travelers can come from all over the place, and they could stay the night in the temple. And in that temple, in the dark, if a snake crawled over you, they'd have snakes. They weren't poisonous snakes, but they said that that would be a healing touch from the God of healing. And so people would flock there and lay in the temple, and in the dark, they'd hope a snake would crawl over them. Creepy, right? And so this place was a place where there are many false gods, many false religions, a place where it says Satan's throne was there. So I think that what it's saying is this was a place of heavy demonic activity. And this church then had specific pressures because of that. So this church at Pergamos, they would be there and they would see all this crazy stuff going on, and yet they would say, you know what, I'm sticking to my faith in Jesus Christ. I'm not wavering, I'm not buckling, I'm sticking to his name. I'm going to be called a Christian. Even though it wasn't a good environment to do that, and even though there are so many pressures to conform. So we can see that we live in a time, in an era where there's so many pressures to conform. There's so many things looking to grab our heart and grab our attention away from the Lord. And this is the seat of where Satan is. In essence, this is the working of Satan. This is what he wants to do, especially for a Christian. He wants us to compromise. Because once you're a Christian, he can't make you not a Christian. So what does he do? He gets you to compromise. Compromise with the world. And so he says, I know your works. I know you're there. And I know you're holding fast to my name. And I know there is a certain guy, a special guy, Antipas. He was killed. And that still didn't make you want to change or to get into a different religion. So that doesn't sound too bad, right? So what's the bad part? Look at verse 14. I have a few things against you. You don't want to hear that. You know that thing if your boss ever says, hey, can we talk for a second? You never think that's a good thing, right? You never think, oh, I'm going to get in. You always think, uh-oh, what did I do? I have a few things against you. Notice what he says. He says, because you have there those who hold to the doctrine of Balaam. So interesting. So here's a subtle thing about this. So this church, they held to the name of Christ, but within the church, they had those who held to the doctrine of Balaam. What's that? So that takes us back to the Old Testament, Numbers chapter 22. You may recall the story. You ever heard of a donkey talking in the Bible? This is that story. Balaam was a prophet of God. Balaam was the guy who was hired by the king of Moab because the king of Moab was afraid of the children of Israel. He knew the children of Israel were coming his way. He heard about the God that was on their side. He heard about their conquests. And so he says, I got problems. I better do something. And so he hires Balaam. And Balaam worked a deal. At first, he said he wouldn't do it. And he just kept kind of manipulating the situation until finally. Finally, he goes. That's where the donkey spoke to him, trying to stop him from going. That's that whole story. But he goes, and he stands on a mountain overlooking the children of Israel. Do you know what he would see? He would see the children of Israel arranged in a specific pattern. In Exodus 2, it says the children of Israel are to camp in a certain formation. And when he would look down from this mountain, he'd see the shape of a cross. He would see the tribes laid out, camped out in the shape of the cross. And he stood up there and he tried to pronounce a curse on them. And you know what happened? He couldn't do it. God wouldn't let him do it. And instead, he pronounced a blessing on them. Imagine Balak, the king of the Moabites, hiring Balaam to pronounce a curse. And he's pronouncing a blessing on him. And he's saying, I'm sorry, man, I can't do it. It just won't happen. God won't let this happen. Something interesting. We can't be cursed because of the cross. See, when you're a Christian, Jesus took the curse, didn't he? And so now it's all about God's goodness, grace, and blessings towards us because of the cross, not because of us. So he does this again and it doesn't work. He does this again and it doesn't work. And finally, he says, this isn't going to work. But I do have a plan. I have a better plan. You see, I can't pronounce a curse on them, but I can teach you how to get them on their own to stray from the Lord. So what did he do? He said, Balak, get your hottest girls, just kidding, but prettiest girls, and send them into the camp. And have these girls with their little idols, have them go into the Israelites' camp and tempt them so that they on their own will stray away from the Lord. They on their own will follow after the false idols. And so what he did is he put a major stumbling block by putting the temptation, and the children of Israel did do that. And what they did is they married their religion with pagan religions, which is exactly what God told them not to do. So notice what he says with that backdrop. He says, Balaam taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel. That's what we just talked about. And it said, to eat things sacrificed to idols. So that's where they're making compromises. And then he says, and to commit sexual immorality. So those are the two hinges on this doctrine of Balaam, which the door swings. And it's the mingling of false things, integrating that into your Christianity, number one. And then number two, it has a very sexually immoral element to it. And he says, basically he's saying that you have people in your church that are into this type of doctrine. Meaning that they are following after. This is an actual religious type of teaching. And the church wasn't doing anything about it. But then he says he has one more thing. He says, thus you also have those who hold to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. So they had the doctrine of Balaam, which was the corruption of the purity of the things of God, intermingling with unspiritual things. And then the doctrine of Nicolaitans, what's that? Well, the doctrine of Nicolaitans, Nico means conquer, Leo means people. So Nicolaitans, the doctrine of Nicolaitans is the conquering of the people. What does that mean? That means within a church, there's a hierarchy to where there are people over people in charge of other people's faith. So that's where the institution of a priesthood and a power structure underneath that, where people are now responsible for other people's faith. It's a control thing. When the Bible says there's one mediator between man and God, and who's that? Jesus Christ. One mediator. This is a religious system that puts people as mediators in between the people and Christ. So he says, I hate that. And so what's the connection? This is interesting. I was thinking about that. I'm like, what's the connection with the doctrine of Balaam and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans kind of all wrapped into one religious structure? And I think what it is this. It's when people can plug into a religious system without having a personal relationship with God. And that allows them to live a life apart from God sinfully, but then relying on the power structure of the church to do the spiritual things for them. So what it comes down to is I can pay my tithes, I can attend church on Sunday, and then just kind of go live my life the way I want to, which is in sin. But then there's a structure in church where they're praying for my sins. And they're the holy ones. And they're doing all that, and my connection with them means that I'm okay. Totally wiping out what Jesus says, that we are to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and our own walk with him. So watch what he says. He just has one correction. We get this sense that this is an urgent thing. He says, repent. This is a message for the church today. This may be a message for some individuals today. You may have an unhealthy marriage or association with the world. You may be relying on something that's not in the Bible, saying something like, well, God's a loving God. I've done a lot of good things. There's no way he could send me to hell. God would never do that. That's not in the Bible. The Bible says you must be born again. The Bible says it's not by works, by our efforts, by the things we do that we can be saved, but it's by our faith in Jesus Christ. So maybe we don't exactly relate to the church at Pergamos, but generally I think this is prevailing in our society, where you can plug into some sort of religious system. Even in evangelical Christianity, we're not off the hook. Because there could be a church that's set up like a machine that you plug into. And you plug into, well, I go every Sunday for an hour. And sometimes I help out. And I sometimes go on trips with them. You can do all that, and if the Word of God is not being taught, you can still not ever be a Christian and never have a relationship with God and think you do because you're doing all the stuff. It's not doing all the stuff that makes you a Christian. It's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That is so important. So what we need to concern ourselves with, what we need to be thinking about as we wrap this up, we need to repent of any and all things that we're substituting for a relationship with Jesus Christ. We need to ask ourselves this question. What is that which is the most influential thing in my life? What influences me? Why am I doing what I do? Why do I live the way I live? What is it? Is it the world that's telling me how to live and what to do? Am I living for the things of the world? Do I make decisions based on what the world tells me? The Bible says you can't love God and the world. You can't do both. The Bible says if you love one, you hate the other. You know that? The Bible teaches us. The world, when I say that, I'm talking about the system of the world. The system of the world is run by Satan and it hates God. It hates God. So it doesn't make any sense to say, I love God, but man, I just love partying so much and sexual immorality and all this stuff. That doesn't square. There's something wrong. That's a corrupt marriage. The Bible calls us to come out of the world system. What does that mean? Not using the world system to dictate to us what truth is, what life is, and how we should do things. Ask yourself this question. Is the word of God, the double-edged sword, is that what I live my life by? Is that what I'm standing on? Because at the end of the day, that is the only thing that's going to hold up before God. So he says, repent. And I think we all need to really think, even if we're the greatest Christian since Paul the Apostle, we live also in a place where there's so many heavy influences. Many of those heavy influences are seen in the Christian church as part of the church, as the adoption of secular things within the church is no big deal. We need to ask ourselves, where has my life or my thinking gotten more worldly than it has heavenly? Where have I gotten off track where I'm living more for the world instead of the kingdom to come? And where is the place where I've put my significance and importance more than the significance of God's glory in my life? Paul said in the book of Philippians that there are a group of people who deny the cross, and it says they're God was their belly. Actually, it says they're enemies of the cross. Their God was their belly. They lived by their own desires. Their glory was their shame. So they lived for their own glory, their self. And this group of people, it says they're enemies of the cross. So wouldn't we need to know that? The gospel says the cross of Jesus Christ applied to our life is that we deny ourselves and we follow Jesus Christ. That's what it means to be a Christian. We deny ourselves and follow Jesus Christ. So why should I do that? What's the point? Well, one is because you and I will all stand before God one day. If you're a believer, you'll stand before God to be rewarded. If you're not a believer, you'll stand before God to be judged. But let's finish with this. If you don't repent, he says, I will come to you quickly and I will fight against him with the sword of my mouth. There it is again. The word of God has to be our standard for everything. And then he says, well, here's the eternal motivation. Here's what you need to think about. Verse 17, He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. And I always pray that I hope to God that the Spirit is speaking to our hearts. It says, to him who overcomes, I will give him some of the hidden manna to eat, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name written, which no one knows except him who receives it. So he's saying, hidden manna. Manna was the provision for the children of Israel in the wilderness. It sustained them. It was everything that they would ever need for their physical body. In Exodus 16, Moses was told to put it in a bottle and save it as something to remember. And I believe that's what the hidden manna is. It's a remembrance. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And so it's the hidden manna is no matter what we lose out on, air quotes, in this world, God himself will supply all our needs. Amen. How? According to his riches in heaven. We never need to worry about what may happen from our following of Jesus Christ. We need to worry about our following of Jesus Christ. And then trust Jesus Christ with what may happen from our following of Jesus Christ. And he will provide the hidden manna, the substance, everything you need. He'll take care of that. What's the white stone? In those days, their athletic events, the winner would get a white stone. And that white stone would have their name on it because they'd have a banquet later. And they can show them the stone with their name on it to get them into the banquet. A lot of Christians in those days, they did not participate in a lot of these events because a lot of these events worship pagan idols, so they weren't part of that. So they're missing out. And God's saying, you're not missing out because you're going to have an entrance into heaven that's so amazing and so specific. You're going to have a special name that I give you, and only you and I are going to know it. The motivation is a spiritual motivation that the things of God are better than the things of the world. And that God is faithful to take care of us. Don't ever worry or think about, man, if I follow Christ, man, I'm going to lose friends. I won't be able to do this. And how am I ever going to do it? Don't worry about all that. Just follow Christ and you'll be amazed how he supplies everything you need. But don't let Satan pull that wool over your eyes and say you can't fully follow Jesus because you're going to be missing out on so much. That's a lie of the enemy. Never compromise your faith in Jesus Christ. Never sell out. Never fall into the temptation because everything we need is found in Jesus Christ alone. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this morning, and I trust that there's a lot of things that you're speaking to people's hearts this morning. I know you've spoke to my heart a lot through this, that I've had a lot to pray about and a lot to think about. And Lord, I would just say, one, for our church here, it's our desire to be right in your eyes. We really want to, Lord. And so, Lord, we commit as a church body to looking to you. And we do repent of the things that aren't right. And we're sorry, Lord. And we do live in a place where corruption is acceptable on a personal level and then just on a corporate church level. And there are many things that we see going on in the church that we don't see in the Bible, and it's accepted as normal. And so, Lord, we just as a church, we want to present ourselves to you, Lord, as a church. Is this a holy living sacrifice? We just say, Lord, we just as a church, we want to be the clay and we want you to mold us and shape us. No matter what the cost may be. And Lord, I pray for those here this morning, maybe just individually, you spoke to their heart somewhere that man, maybe somebody here, the worst thing is to be in a condition where the world is influencing you more than God, and you think that's normal, and you've accepted it. And I pray that the Holy Spirit would speak to your heart right now, awaken you. That your heart would get the shock paddles of a defibrillator just to wake you up. That these things are all around us. It's scary what's happening. And Lord, you've called us out of the world to stand on your truth, to be a beacon of light, to be salt of the earth. And so, Lord, I pray for anybody here first that if they're a Christian and they've just compromised so much, maybe they just didn't realize it. Maybe it's a slow descend into compromise, Lord. Help us to open our eyes to the things that are not of you, Lord. As you say in your Psalms, let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be pleasing to you, Lord. Your yoke is easy, your burden is light. You're so sweet, Lord. And I pray for anybody here this morning that as we read through the Word, that maybe you've realized that you're trusting in or counting on something that's wrong. You have to realize, you have to give your life to Jesus Christ. I just want to pray for anybody here this morning that you would say, you know, I don't think I've ever truly walked with God. I don't think I've really been born again. I want to pray for anybody here who's maybe saying, well, somehow I'll make it to heaven, and I'm a good person. And if that's you, you're just making up your own thing. The Bible does not say that. And so this morning, I pray that you would repent and give your life to Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, every one of us. And the penalty of sin is death. That means eternal separation from God. That means hell for eternity. But at the same time, God demonstrated his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, that whoever would believe in their heart and confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord and rose from the dead, that they would be saved. You can put your faith in Jesus Christ right now, right here. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. The prayer is not a magic formula. The prayer is you saying, God, forgive me, help me, I'm sorry. If that's you, pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. And Lord, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose again from the dead. And now, Lord, I put my faith in you. I put my faith in you, Lord. I turn from my way and I say, I put my faith in you. Fill me with your Holy Spirit, Lord, and help me to walk with you all the days of my life. I
know that you are holy. I know that you are holy.